Natasha Crampton of Microsoft, thanks for joining me today.
Pleasure to be here.
You know, I wanted to start by just sorting through some of the hyperbole that we've been hearing about AI. I mean, literally, we went from AI is going to take away some of our jobs to headlines about potential human extinction, and that's pretty wide range. Can we sort of level set on where is particularly generative AI right now?
Sure. So, look, I think it is an important time to be having a very broad conversation about AI, making sure that we're hearing from everyone, both as to their concerns, but also their aspirations for what we can achieve. And here at UNGA, that's exactly what this week has been about. I also do think, though, it is important to sort of apply a risk-based lens to what we're talking about and help use that to help us harness the technology in the places where it makes sense right now. So if you think about the current capability of today's, especially cutting-edge systems, they've got amazing benefits in sort of everyday productivity applications. I've been using some of the co-pilots that Microsoft has produced, and that just makes me more efficient at work and helps me do my job better. I think we've seen some exciting scientific breakthroughs as well. There are concerns in the future about making sure that, you know, AI remains under human control, a critically important policy objective. But I don't think we're at the point here where we are sort of concerned that that out of control AI is actually going to eventuate. But having this risk-based approach really does help us systematically work through the risks and make sure we've got the right mitigations in place.
On that point about human control, I was thinking about this morning, actually, like, what do I want to ask Natasha? And I thought to myself, you know, the best conversations with my with the IT people who help us in the office tend to end with turn it off, turn it on, wait 10 seconds, right? Is there an on-off switch for AI in the broadest sense, and should there be?
Look, we've advanced the idea that there should be safety breaks for AI in the same way that there are safety breaks for other critical systems that we rely on in our lives. Now, today's systems very often have humans in the loop, right? When I use a co-pilot at Microsoft in my day-to-day work, get some output in response to a prompt that I put into the system, and then I, as a human being, make the decision about whether to accept that output straight away. I might edit it. That's more often the way in which I use it. So I think Microsoft's philosophy is that we should treat these AI systems as co-pilots to advance human ends. But thinking about what these safety breaks will look like going forward is sort of a system-specific decision. The basic idea of them is that we need to build systems in a way that have operational envelopes that they remain within. We need to be able to detect unintended behaviors and be able to slow down and pause, just the way, in the same way that, you know, we've built safety breaks into school buses that make parents feel confident that to put their children on the bus in the morning. We've got them in elevators to make sure that we're confident using those. So it's the same concept, but we need to apply it in a technology sense. But it is absolutely the case that, you know, it remains under our control today, in part because we decide where to put the AI systems to work.
So then I guess the next question is about if there were that figurative on-off switch, you know, who flips it? The government, tech companies, civil society, where does it come from? And, you know, when we talk about the issue of regulation, you know, first, we've heard a lot of proposals, particularly over the past couple of weeks, as all, from the G20 to Ursula von der Leyen's State of the EU speech to what's been happening at the UN, as though this is a new concept, right? I mean, AI regulation, conversations about it have been around for a while. They have not advanced very far in general. So do you have a concern that they're, A, not moving fast enough, and that the technology itself just keeps moving? And what impact will that have ultimately?
Yeah, so I think, you know, in thinking about safety architectures generally, I think it's really important to embrace the idea that as the technology developers, we have the first responsibility to make sure that we are designing our systems with that safety architecture baked in. And we will continue to do that at Microsoft. I've been in the fortunate position of having this role now for 4 years. So we've been building this internal practice of responsible AI by design over that period of time. Even with all of the measures that we take, though, we do also believe governments have a role to play here, and in particular to draw lines about what is going to be acceptable and unacceptable uses of AI systems based on societal values and decisions that need to be made there. So you can imagine, for example, a situation where the government says that, yes, for critical infrastructure, we do need special safety brakes, and we should be able to exercise safety brakes at different levels of the technology stack. So I think it is absolutely a combination of company-led efforts, and every AI developer should have a very high sense of their responsibility there. But we also need governments as well. We need national regulation. We also need international governance, which is what the conversation here this week is all about. Now, in terms of government regulation, you're right. There's actually been ongoing conversations in this space for some time now. And we shouldn't lose sight of the fact that there are many existing laws on the books that should be applied to AI. So one task that we have in front of us is making sure that our regulators, our policymakers, our judges are all well equipped to apply the existing laws on the books. And then subsequently, for AI-specific laws, you know, we've seen some growing momentum there, and I think that's right, because people do need protection under the law here. We've seen the Europeans working on the AI Act for almost 2.5, coming on 3 years now, and we've seen it evolve as the technology has evolved, and that's appropriate too. Other initiatives, such as the White House commitments that came out earlier this year, another good example of a concrete step forward. So I think the key thing to do in this moment is to make sure that these efforts are sort of incremental. They build upon one another so that we are starting to build a well-developed, well-reconciled regulatory system that combines the best of industry standards, national regulation, and ultimately international governance as well.
Yeah, I was going to ask about it. So earlier today, we hosted a conversation on the Christchurch call, which, mm-hmm. for those of you who don't know, came out of a 2019 terror attack in your home country of New mm-hmm. Zealand, actually, and led to some firm commitments from governments and private sector and civil society alike. The question that came to my mind watching and producing that hour was essentially, I remember the days, which were not too long ago, when social media companies and tech companies were a little more combative with governments, right? And certainly in the US that was true. To what extent do you think the past few years and maybe this AI moment has led to greater cooperation between tech companies and the government, and to what extent the government now feels we need tech companies at the table?
I have seen really positive moves in that direction, and I think it's essential. You know, as AI labs on the cutting edge of this technology, we do have special knowledge about how the technology was built, what the safeguards are, what works well, what doesn't work so well, and that information is critically important to a regulatory conversation. And at the same time, it shouldn't be left to technology companies alone. We do need the combination of technologists, we need governments, we need civil society all at the table. It does need to be a very multi-stakeholder approach.
Yeah. And then finally, so because you are the chief responsible AI officer at Microsoft, you obviously are deeply familiar with and helped to construct many of the regulations that your own company has in place. How can what's already happening in tech companies be translated toward a global framework?
That's a great question. So I'd point to three things. First, within the company, when we do our responsible AI work, we have engineers working alongside policy people, working alongside researchers. We have technical people, and we have social scientists. And I think this very multidisciplinary approach is just essential to getting AI regulation right. Second, I would say that we've learned that it's really important to take a risk-based approach. And AI is not a single thing, it's a constellation of technologies, and different use cases have very different implications. Using facial recognition on your phone to secure your device is a very different thing to using facial recognition in a public square, and we should make sure that the regulation is calibrated accordingly. And then finally, I'd say we should build upon existing frameworks. I've been in this role now for 4 years. We built frameworks ahead of this generative AI revolution that continue to be durable. We've needed to expand and make sure we consider additional risk frameworks, but we should build from what we have already and make sure that we are learning from other regulatory models, harnessing the best of them, and then adapting them for what we need in this AI context.
Natasha Crampton, thank you so much.
Thank you.